Today we'll visit Brookwood Farm, where you will learn all about the history of farming in the Blue Hills. I'm Judy Lehrer Jacobs, the Executive Director of the Friends of the Blue Hills.
I'm Sarah Rossenpour, and I'm the new farm manager at Brookwood Community Farm.
And if you have visited Brookwood or have questions about Brookwood Farm, please let us know in the comments. You are watching Blue Hills Alive, your weekly guide to the Blue Hills. And we are grateful to our sponsor, Tom O'Neill of Success Realty in Milton. And he sponsors these videos every week, Thursday at noon. If you have photos of the Blue Hills, we'd love to see them in our photo contest. And we'll put the link in the comments below. It's friendsofthebluehills.org/photo-contest. We can start. So Sarah, you are brand new to Brookwood Farm. So what was your background that allowed you to just walk into a farming job?
So I started farming 9 years ago, I think. I've only farmed in the Northeast, so I'm from Minnesota originally. And I was a graduate student at Cornell at their vegetable research farm. I actually studied things like weed science there for vegetable production. It's a little colder up there, which is, it's nice because it only gets better when you're here. And I also worked at Revision Urban Farm in Dorchester nearby, which is how I first heard of Brookwood Community Farm, was when I worked there. And then the last 4 years I worked at Lansing in Weston, and it's a bigger farm, it's more like 20 acres. So yeah, it was big and complex, so this, you know, like when I saw the opportunity available here, it just seemed perfect. A lot of community involvement. Yeah, it's a lot smaller.
Yeah,
it's very less than an acre total.
Wow. So you've done urban and rural farming.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a long history at Brookwood of farming.
Yeah.
Can you give me a little bit of the history of Brookwood farm?
Sure. It's been at least a couple of centuries. I know that I think it was a general that owned the land a while ago, and he had like working cattle and sheep and that sort of thing. And then most recently, we actually met with the daughter of a man who ran mostly horses over here. But so she lived here when it was a working farm in one of the houses, if you go further up there, up the hill. So it was mainly horses, but it was completely a working farm. So a little over 10 years ago, when Judy Lieberman and Mark Smith, who had both been involved with the local food movement, saw this land, they saw it as an opportunity to kind of open up local food opportunities and bring it back to being a working farm again, which is nice because it's a location that's near Boston, where there's all these people hungry for local food.
Right. So it actually, they didn't grow things historically?
No, they did. They did grow things. I think they probably grew vegetables specifically for themselves, and then you usually grow like fodder for the animals to eat as well. So it's part of like a whole system.
Okay. And now it's a CSA. Do you want to talk about what that is?
Sure, yeah. CSA stands for Community Supported Agriculture, and it's a system where people support the farm by buying shares up front, so they're buying a share of the harvest. So every week they come in and they get a little bit of what we're harvesting. So they share in the risks of the farm and they share in the bounty of the farm. If deer come in and eat all our cucumbers, it's going to be a little sparse on that. But on the other hand, it's also been really sunny and like perfect weather for tomatoes, and people get a lot of tomatoes. So it's kind of fun. You get kind of a more of a handle on, you know, what it's like to grow in the area, and more of a connection to your local farm and the local community as well. And we also try to give people a little bit more than they paid for, so it's a better deal overall, even though there's some fluctuation in what you get. And we also grow really delicious varieties, because we're not growing for it to be sent all the way across the country. It's for people right here.
Mm-hmm. And you don't provide food just for like local people that are buying into the CSA. Where else do you sell them, or where else does it go?
Yeah, well, we do have, if people are signed up for our newsletter, we do have harvest bags occasionally. So, or I shouldn't say occasionally, it's every so often. If we have a bounty or something, that we sell that. We also sell at the Roslindale Market weekly, so people from that part of Boston can come. And we do a lot of donations too. So I believe the Canton and Milton Food Pantry, Germantown and Quincy, Rosie's Place, which is in Boston, and the Boston Area Gleaners, where I'm wearing their hat, also come in too. They can glean your coolers, but they can also glean your fields. If, like, let's say we have a ton of something, and no one in the CSA wants like 20 pounds more cabbage, but there are people that would be happy to have it, but maybe we don't have the time to get to it, so they can come and harvest it, and they work with volunteers and get that out.
Is it often that fresh fruit goes to food pantries?
I think maybe more often than it used to be, because we have all these local farms like Brookwood in the community that are distributing it, but I think, no, generally, food pantries have been like shelf-stable foods and not always healthy ones. Or you can, I mean, the vegetables you'd be getting would be like just canned vegetables,
right,
like peaches and, well, fruit, but peaches and syrup or canned green beans. So.
And education is part of your mission at Brookwood Farm. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so we do education in a variety of ways. Sometimes we have more formal programming, like with an educator. This year we don't, but we have educational workshops that are in development that will be posted on our website, like cooking classes. I think part of being a CSA member or volunteer is being like educated on the food and how we grow and our growing practices while you're here. Because we'll have different volunteer opportunities that we'll be advertising. And then another big part is with our employees. If you think about most farms in the country, the labor that comes is they're just grunt workers, right? They're just expected to, you know, help produce a lot. But here we're really focused on building up and educating the people that are working with us so that they can continue to use that knowledge and be part of the local food.
That's great. So if you have any questions about Brookwood Farm or about farming in general, let us know in the comments below. So there's still snow on the ground. What's going on? You can't grow in the field.
Yeah, no, we're waiting for the snow to melt and everything to drain out so we can get the tractors in the field. That's when we start, so TBD. But there's still a ton going on our end. So we have a greenhouse here, but over at the Bradley Estate, owned by the trustees just a mile away, is our Bradley greenhouse, and that one has heat. So it's full, yeah, there's a lot of plants in it. I've been posting on our Instagram page. Because everything, not everything, but a lot of what we put out here, we transplant, starting in the greenhouse with heat, so it can get an early start. Because if you didn't plant tomatoes until it was June, you wouldn't get them until it started to freeze again. So there's that, there's fixing things, there's always a million, like, organizational things to do, preparing for our big plant sale that we're going to have, so there's a lot going on behind the scenes.
Are you using the greenhouse here?
The greenhouse here? We do use it. We're not using it yet. It's still kind of cold, but what we will use it for later is we'll bring over plants before they're ready to go out to kind of harden off and get used to the fluctuating temperatures that are in there.
Uh-huh.
They'll still be protected from the wind. And then you can also use it. Greenhouses are important, for example, for curing onions. So after you harvest storage onions, you let them sit in there and kind of dry out so that they can be stored. So onions and garlic and that sort of thing.
It's easier.
Yeah. So it's we definitely use it. We're just not using it yet.
Right. And you're not an organic, certified organic farm, but you use organic practices.
Yeah.
What's the difference?
Yeah. So the organic program was formed a number of years ago as the organic food movement was becoming more predominant because probably, you know, there were surely a lot of companies that wanted to take advantage of the labeling and the price premium. And so it was important to kind of defend the integrity of that label. For smaller firms like us, it doesn't necessarily make sense because there's a lot of paperwork involved, so it's a good program, but here people can talk with us and they can see what we do and we can show them exactly everything we do. So all of the time and money involved in getting certified doesn't really make sense for us, but we do follow the practices.
Right. And so what's the difference? Can you give an example of?
Yeah.
Grown and sure.
Yeah. So if you are going to spray any pesticides, it would have to be at the last resort, and it would only be OMRI certified. It's an institute that reviews these materials, pesticides, and yeah, it would only be the last resort. Some of them are pretty simple, like there's gardening soaps you can use. So there's that. There's also things like we do mechanical weed control, either hand pulling or with the tractors, basically just killing them that way. So we aren't going to use any herbicide. For insects, sometimes, if you can imagine, it's all white now, but you'll see it looks like white sheets in the field, and that's row cover that we put as like an exclusionary barrier to keep certain insects out, because it's much easier to keep them out than to spray, you know, caustic chemicals.
It's certainly white there now. Is it plastic sheets?
Yeah, there. It's like a spun polypropylene or some sort of material like that. Yeah. So if it wasn't white out, we could walk around the farm. You could see row cover that we've been saving and using year to year.
And what kind of veggies do you grow?
We grow a ton of different vegetables. Like I said, everything we grow is, you know, it needs to be flavorful and delicious as well as nutritious. So we grow a lot of basics like onions and carrots and lettuce, that things that people would really expect to have. And we also grow some kind of more interesting, fancier things like French breakfast radishes or kohlrabi or fennel. So it gives people an opportunity to learn about a vegetable that they maybe didn't know is actually really delicious.
Uh-huh.
And then a lot of varieties of each one too. So if you can imagine, like tomatoes, a lot of different heirlooms.
So if you have questions about Brookwood or about heirloom vegetables, please let us know. Do you want to let us know about heirloom vegetables, just how they're different than your
There's a few different definitions. A vegetable doesn't have to be heirloom to be good, because nowadays people are breeding using some of these older varieties. But one of the definitions is it's at least 40 years old or from the 1800s, there's different definitions like that. But the idea is that they were breeding them before they were breeding just for shipping, okay? So the flavor, they're supposed to be more flavorful, basically. So a lot of the heirloom tomatoes have been, every year it changes a little bit, you know, like you're always sort of selecting for whatever is growing best in your area when you grow seed. Yeah, but basically more flavorful vegetables.
I heard they were supposed to be more nutritious than
Yeah, that's often true too, yeah.
How can people sign up for the CSA?
That's a good question. If people go to our website, brookwoodcommunityfarm.org, there'll be a link to where they can sign up for CSAs on our Shopify site. And I believe there's likely also a link to have an Instagram and Facebook page, and so we link to all that there as well.
And since this is your first year, what are you looking forward to the most at Brookwood Farm?
I think I'm looking forward most to meeting all the people and all the local community members that are part of the farm and make it what it is.
Great. And I think that's all my questions. Do you have anything else you want to add?
I think if people are interested in learning more about the farm, they can go to our website or our Instagram page has a lot of pretty pictures. Our Facebook page, we try to put any events or volunteer opportunities on there. So it's a good way to see if you want to get involved.
Great, thank you. And if you have great photos of either the farm or any place in the Blue Hills, we'd love for you to submit them to our photo contest, which is free at friendsofthebluehills.org/photo-contest, and there's a link in the comments. You're watching Blue Hills Alive, your weekly guide to the Blue Hills, and we are grateful to our sponsor, Tom O'Neill of Success Realty in Milton, and we hope to see you next Thursday at noon when Professor Richard Prinoff will be talking about climate change and the Blue Hills. Thanks, and see you next Thursday.
You were awesome. I always want to get too technical.